And in the beginning, windsurfing wasn't even really a sport. Most people didn't even know what it was. I'd be sitting on a plane coming home from somewhere, and the guy next to me would ask, oh, what do you do? I'm a professional windsurfer. And they'd go, oh, you jump off mountains? And literally, they didn't even know what it was.
It's like a bug, man. It gets inside of you, and you can't get rid of it.
It's like all of a sudden, the two sports that I love got married.
And any one of the top, you know, 20 guys could have won, you know, from the waltzers through the Nashes and then the super talented gnarly guys like the Angulos.
Kai first wrote me a letter asking for sponsorship when he was really young. And it was written in pencil. It's all like mistakes corrected and stuff. Super cool.
Some people know what they want to do with their life. And that determination, it'll take you your whole life.
Returning to Cabo Verde offered Josh a clean slate in many regards. And it got him away from Maui, which was the cause for a lot of his problems.
The first time I was in Cape Verde is relatively new. The town was small and the wave was just being discovered by the windsurf world. So when we got the call from Josh to come ride, we were really psyched. Because after living there for 5 years, we knew he had the place unlocked. We showed up at 4 a.m, in typical Josh fashion, he had a whole other mission lined up.
Just tell us straight up, you know what, guys, I meet you in like a couple of hours and we take a boat and go to the next island.
And we kind of realized what kind of trip we were on at that point and what Josh Angulo had planned for us. Because I knew, once we saw that pier and we're getting in that boat, I knew Josh was up to something. think this is my life. I get to travel around the world with my best friends and ride perfect waves. You know, I owe this trip to windsurfing. Without it, I wouldn't have had this experience. You know, Josh probably would have never met his wife. I owe so much to the people who created this amazing sport. Their ideas have taken me around the world.
In 1935, Oahu, Hawaii, Tom Blake mounted a traditional mast and sail to his longboard and called it surfboard sailing. But it was not until 1967, Malibu, California, when Hoyle Schweitzer and Jim Drake invented the articulating mast and added the wishbone boom that modern windsurfing was born. 3 years later, Hoyle Schweitzer introduced the windsurfer, the world's first production sailboard. Windsurfing quickly spread overseas and caught on in Europe, where by the late 1970s, one in every three European households owned a sailboard. Back in the Hawaiian Islands, Oahu, with its lighter winds and smaller surf, offered a perfect learning ground for the sport and its early equipment.
You know, honestly, the conditions on Oahu at the time were better for what I was doing than Maui. The surf wasn't that big. We didn't want all that much wind, you know.
But, you know, that's all we knew what windsurfing was these big boards. If you had a really good, lightweight stock windsurfer, it weighed 42 pounds.
Windsurfing was just getting going. There were only like 10 windsurfers in Hawaii when I bought my first board.
We were getting complete airborne with no footsteps. My son, Zane, just laughs when he sees a picture of me 2 feet in the air, and I go, hey, let's see you do that, bub. It's not easy.
Recently moved to Maui in October of 1978, Mike Waltz, while driving the north shore of the island, came across Hokipa State Park.
And then when we drove by Hokipa, I lost it. The entire outer reef and all the wind and just blew my mind. I couldn't believe, you know, what I was seeing and that it was perfectly sideshore.
After sailing Hokipa, it was apparent the 4-meter boards were too long for the larger, steeper waves of the North Shore.
I really wanted to start making smaller boards. I got on the phone, I called Jerry Lopez, and I said, do you have any old surfboards that we can buy? Pipeline boards, like pipeline guns. I mean, we went straight to Hokipa, went out on these boards, and they actually worked unbelievable.
On that day, a photographer happened to be shooting, and Windsurfer magazine later published a spread from that session. And in doing so, started the shortboard revolution.
All of a sudden, it wasn't this kind of dorky sailboat in the surf kind of a thing. You know, all of a sudden, the population of windsurfing started to grow because people went, wow, that looks kind of cool.
The sport was changing every single day. You know, new equipment, new moves. And
there was carbon fiber came on the scene. Everything went from heavy to super light.
Everyone's doing forward loops and I mean, so quickly, it was like, okay, now they're trying double forwards.
The shorter, less buoyant boards, often called sinkers, required stronger winds to perform. As a result, the focus of windsurfing shifted from Oahu to the stronger winds of Maui's North Shore. And most particularly, it was the beach of Hokipa State Park that drew everyone's attention.
For as long as I can remember, you know, looking at, you know, the TV, magazine articles, all the hot favorites, you know, everything was just from Maui.
All the mags was only filled up with all the people in Maui. That was all I saw. I mean, there was Mike Waltz, who had Schweitzer. Oh, and then the rumor would be, oh, I heard Robbie's flying in today. But when I saw him in his true essence arriving at Hokipa, so he was like the king walking into his castle.
A lot of the best guys in the world ended up making this their training ground.
And then all the money surged in too. All the
people that wanted to inject so much money into the sport and
cash came and all the Europeans came and the TV came and the thing was, it was big.
And they were televised all over the world and the whole cliff was just littered from pavilions all the way down to Hokipa of just people and cars and cameras. It was like being in Hollywood, man. I tell you, it was a good time.
If you wanted to be anybody in the world of windsurfing, you had to go to Hokipa. You had to go through Hokipa, and you had to go through the guys that were at Hokipa.
Hokipa in the 90s was a pretty heavy place. It was unpoliced. It was a free-for-all, really crowded spot.
It wasn't like any mysterious, hey, I heard about something over here or something over there. You knew you were right where you were supposed to be because everything was coming together, man. The planets were lining up, and the wind was coming. And we were gonna go learn how to do loops and the future was setting up just for the taking.
In 1987, a young Aussie motocross champion came to Maui. By the late 90s, his go-for-broke attitude had earned him two windsurfing world titles and influenced an entire generation.
Hey, down here team with Jason. It's not Polakow, is it? It's Polakow.
Yeah.
Now, team, Jason's probably the hottest bikey in Australia this very day.
Risk-taking and adventure run in the youngster's blood. He was Australian junior motocross champion before the age of 10, but gave up playing in the dirt at the request of his parents, who now fully support their son in his new career as a professional windsurfer.
I had to find another sport that kind of, you know, was the same as motorbike riding. It gave you that adrenaline rush, you know, gave you that really good feeling. And really tennis and footy and cricket didn't really give me that buzz, and windsurfing did.
Man, I tell you, I have broken just so many bones over my period. I've done my foot, I've done my knee, I've done my wrists, I've done my head, I've done just about everything. But, you know, man, it was all worth it. I've had so much fun. I wouldn't, if I had to do it over, I'd do it all the same.
The call actually that Jaws was going to be good this week. Decided to can Jaws and come over here to the North Shore of Oahu and hit backyards. And it's a pretty famous spot for windsurfing. It hasn't been shot for about 10 years. I think we made the right call. Maui was socked in with rain.
And looking at it now, it's like perfect sunshine. The wind came up to about, what, 35 knots?
40 knots.
40 knots. Probably had a little injury.
You gotta be careful walking in the backyard.
He might need to seek medical attention.
We'll be right back.
One thing that I've learned from being on Maui all these years is that the talent keeps rising and the moves just keep getting bigger.
The sailing now
was not possible
back in the day.
You couldn't have even imagined a real windsurfer on a real wave. Now you take a little toy windsurfer and go, imagine if you could do that and like fly in the air. And now we do it every day.
It's taken about 20 years, but the sailing now is deserving of that kind of attention again.
Now is a great time to be a windsurfer.
As windsurfing's first generation has grown up and had families, they've started to pass the sport on to their children. Answering the call, manufacturers have released a whole range of gear specifically designed for kids. As a result, for the first time ever, there is a worldwide youth movement in windsurfing. Leading the charge is a young Hawaiian waterman.
Thank you. At playtime, I usually just watch the trees, and right after school, my dad picks me up, go straight to Hakifa, down to the beach.
Middle name kind of gave it away and set things in motion for what was to come, I think. Waterman. Other than being a miniature version, he's one of the best riders out there in terms of looking at his wave knowledge and watching the dynamics of his riding.
From Sylt, these past couple days have been no windsurfing, just sitting down. A little cold, but all the pros are out and we're having so much fun.
One thing's for certain, Kai Lenny's going to be one of the future figureheads of this sport if he chooses to continue to follow the windsurfing path.
With a young star like Robby Naish before him, Kai is setting his sights high.
I want to compete on the World Cup. That's how Robby made his mark on the sport, and that's the road I want to go down.
Well, for me, the sport for a really long time was based around competition. It was my everything, my whole life, my whole approach to living was competition. You could never do anything if you're going to an event or from event, that's all you would do. Because there's no way you could do anything with all this gear in between. It would all get stolen or lost, or if it was a three-discipline World Cup, 10 boards. 14 rigs and a mast, a boom, and a base for every one of those sails, because you have to have them all rigged all the time, ready to go. So for 25 years flying around, I never saw anything anywhere I went, because I just went straight into the event site and straight out. It's classic. Well, I've never actually counted how many trophies I've got or how many events I've won or placed in over the years. At least got a room for them now, for all the trophies that I've got somewhere to live, which is cool. That's a special one. That's actually the first real event I ever won. It's 1976 Regional Kailua Oahu, Hawaii. No, I'm proud of what I've done. I'm amazed that I've stayed as passionate about it as I have for as long as I have, but I'm as fired up about it today as I was 25 years ago. My life right now pretty much rocks, because I still consider myself a professional athlete, which is cool at 44. I can sail what I want, where I want, how I want. Katie and I just had a baby girl, Christina Catherine Kaiulani Naish. You know, I've replaced the competition side with the business side, and that's keeping me driven, you know, and having fun, not just on the water, but behind the scenes as well. It's a lot easier to travel now too, because I can get on a plane with one board bag and one sail bag and off I go. And there's not 300 kilos of gear following me around. So it's exciting, exciting times. It's like being a kid again.
While Robby was competing, he won 23 world titles. Today, the PWA has three main disciplines: race, wave, and the exploding category of freestyle. In Europe, they even go as far to hold events indoors.
Like they're in. Kevin Pritchard, and our winner, Josh Angulo. Congratulations!
As a 19-year-old kid, skier, golfer, go to the beach kind of kid, and went up to Utah for a one-week ski trip. The weather was bad, storms were storming, and some too much gin had been ginned. A good 2.5 weeks later, I opened my eyes in a room with no way to talk, lots of IVs. Somewhere in there, it really hit me that, you know, I wasn't gonna cut some plaster cast off my leg. And it never occurred to me that I'd be, you know, riding a little cat board that was invented by a group of friends. And you know, the times that seem slow are well made up for the times when you catch the little wave and see the right nose or the left nose or the two both go underwater. It's an effort, but it makes the experience all the more a gift, I guess. If I was solo, I wouldn't be out there doing this stuff. So I'm a pretty lucky boy.
With 2 weeks to go before the World Cup in Cabo Verde, I told Levi we should leave a little early and meet Boujma in Morocco. I've been there before. I knew it would be something we would not forget. I've lived in Hawaii for 8 years, and it feels like home. The people, the crowded waves, the conditions are so familiar now. Morocco is such a contrast to Maui. The reefs, the currents, the winds. I knew there would be empty waves we knew nothing about, except for what we saw with our own eyes. After all, it's good to get away from home once in a while and push the reset button.
Oh,
Exploration is a road of uncertainty. When we set out on this trip, we had no idea we'd score these epic waves. At the same time, we didn't realize we could have missed the contest.
We're stuck. We lost our crew. They took off without us.
If you always know what you're going to get, then it's not really an adventure.
You know, it's easy to stay at your local spot. But if you don't get out there and search, you'll never know what you're missing. This is the kind of place my brother and I would have dreamed about as kids. Back in Hawaii, we were these fortunate sons who had parents that believed in us. Growing up, they sold everything we had and moved us over to Maui.
In the early 90s, there wasn't any other kids around. I mean, I remember being at Hokipa with my brother and seeing the whole spectacle. You know, helicopters flying around, people on the hill. You know, there was no juniors division, and it was intimidating.
When we started the sport, we had no idea where it'd take us. We just did it for the pure joy of windsurfing.
You know, it wasn't never the sponsors, the recognition, or any of that. There's this unexplainable freedom that only a windsurfer knows.
I carry those days with me, everywhere I go.
And once I step off that beach into the water, that's my shot to show the world what I'm made of.
Yeah.
So we're on our way again. The Cabo Verde forecast was calling for a huge swell with nuking winds. Things were lining up to be the best contest in windsurfing's history. But as our luck would have it, we were stuck in a Moroccan snowstorm at 7,000 feet. We were one of the last five cars the police allowed through the mountain pass, but we still missed our flight on the first day of competition. Lucky for us, due to the lack of wind, no heats were held on day one. Day two was a different story.
Best days of my life. Windsurfing has gone to another level.
First round of competition, the final was set between Josh Angulo and Cowley Sadie.
Yeah, well, Josh Angulo is the younger brother of Mark Angulo, who is one of the sport's stars. There's a lot of temptation in the world for a young athlete anywhere, but the North Shore of Maui is an especially difficult place to grow up.
He was in a deeper, darker place than we had even realized. Over the course of a couple years, a couple contests, Josh kind of fell out.
It was the spring 2000 wave event.
He was either going to go up to pavilions and get high, or he was going to stay down and he was going to win a windsurf contest.
And it only took that one contest when he really melted down to understand that.
And I'm like, dude, listen, you just got to come sail one heat, you know? And he was like, bye, I ain't going to sail no heat, you know?
And he like crawls out of the bushes for his heat, staggering. Can barely walk, so therefore he can barely sail.
Looking back, I probably made a mistake encouraging him to even go in the water, you know what I mean?
And then he just comes back and collapses in the sand, and he throws a pile of sand at a $50,000 camera.
I started pushing the camera guys away. I don't ever remember doing that in my life before. And, you know, basically we just asked God to, hey, help us make it through today, right here, you know? He had a choice to make in his life, you know? What was he gonna do? And it would kind of, it just went to show how much we can just get taken away from the true things we love by drugs, alcohol, or these distractions. And he went and he got, you know, he went the other way. He went the wrong way.
I had no problem throwing everything away. And I did.
I threw everything away. Sponsors, money, boards, cash, everything. I had zero. I went to having zero. No place to live, no money, no shoes, no clothes.
That was the last straw for a lot of people with Josh, certainly for his sponsors, his family, his friends. But the sobering moment must have been when he realized he had lost his wife.
Claudia was there and she's like, dude, I'm done with you. I'm going back to Cape Verde. I don't want to know about you. My family said, I don't want to know about you anymore. We can't handle this anymore. And in all honesty, when people are going down the wrong road in their life and have like substance abuse problems, there's not really that much you can do for them. They got to figure it out on their own.
So he must have at some point looked in the mirror in the morning and said, you know what? I want it. You know, I'm going to take it. I'm not going to lose it.
Coming around, you're able to humble yourself and go back to certain people and be like, hey, you were right. I was wrong. And thank you. And I'm sorry. And those things that help heal relationships and reopen doors that may have previously been closed. And, God's given it all back to me. And then some.
Moving to Cabo Verde provided Josh with a clean slate. And it got him away from Maui, which was the cause for a lot of his problems. I would go as far as to say that Josh is the national hero of that country. A nation that's identifying with windsurfing as its biggest provider of a champion. I mean, it puts windsurfing, let alone Josh, at such a huge level.
Obviously, coming into it as somewhat of a favorite, as well as this being my homeland and the country that I represent, I felt a lot of pressure, not pressure, but a lot of responsibility more than anything to perform at a very high end and to try to win this event.
He'd trade that world title, all those Suquipa wins, everything he's ever done in windsurfing for that single moment. That win meant everything to Josh.
Oh, Cinnamon, where you gonna run to? Cinnamon, where you gonna run to? Where you gonna run to? All on that day, will I run to the rock? Please hide me and run to the rock. Please hide me and run to the rock. Please hide me, Lord, all on that day. But the rock cried out, I can't hide you, the rock cried out. I can't hide you, the rock cried out. I ain't gonna hide you, Dad, all on that day. I said, Rock, what's the matter with you, Rock? Don't you see I need you, Rock? Lord, 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 all on that day. So I ran to the river. It was bleeding around to the sea. It was bleeding around to the sea. It was bleeding all on that day. So I ran to the river. It was boiling around to the sea. It was boiling around to the sea. It was boiling all on that day. So I ran to the Lord. Please help me, Lord. Don't you see me praying? Don't you see me down here praying? But the Lord said, go to the devil. The Lord said, go to the devil. He said, go to the devil all on that day. So I ran to the devil. He was waiting around to the devil. He was waiting around to the devil. He was waiting all on that day. I cried, power, 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 power. Don't you know I need you, Lord? Don't you know that I need you? Don't you know that I need you?
At one point, I remember I almost gave up. I just kind of took another shot at it, and this gust of wind came across the water, and it hit me just right. And I felt that first bit of acceleration, you know, that first point that really grabs you in windsurfing. It's funny how sometimes it's those little moments that really change the course of your life.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul and faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate. Meet you. Hope you guess my name. But what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. Stuck around St. Petersburg when I saw it was a time for change. Killed the Tsar and his ministers. Anastasia screamed in vain. I rode a tank, held a generous rank. When the blitzkrieg raged and the bodies stank. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name. Oh yeah. I was puzzling you with the nature of my game. Oh yeah. Watch me glee while you kings and queens bought my tender cage for the gods they made. I shouted out, who killed the Kennedys? When after all, it was you and me.
Robby, let's make it official. It is over. Okay? I'll see you all later. I'm going snorkeling.
I need traps for troubadours who get killed before they reach.
And I watch these other guys, they lose their stuff. You see them bobbling out there.
Yeah, I went in the rocks. Yeah, you dog paddled to your stuff.
It swam.
Should have told me that earlier.
Dog loose! Pain! There's a dog loose. Guys, just drenching the wall, dude.
Give me some of those legs. Let's see your spring edition.
No, Levi, this one's for you. Slow-mo.
Hi, Baptiste. What can I get for you?
I'm doing for a cappuccino
tomorrow. Oh, hey. How was that Brazilian bug wax?
A couple times I had these mist of bomber airs, and I looked down, and like, there he is right there, all in the pit. I'm like, yeah, you can try getting some.
Oh, wow, what a day. Yeah, guys, check it out. Waves.